Good morning or good afternoon, depending where you are. I welcome you very cordially to this UENPS webinar, and I thank Professor Corrado Moretti for inviting me to talk about becoming a human being. To make it clear very early on, we are always human beings. Consequently, I will rather describe the stages and the influences of becoming a full human being, a person. I will first explain the difference between beginning and start, then discuss being and becoming a person, then describe all influences from A to D, which result in the formation of our basic structure, our foundation. And so I will at the end discuss the foundation and its consequences. Beginning is the opening of a whole, of a totally new life, is that unknown which has begun with us to be. Being implements the appearing of what will, but has not yet become manifest. We do not know what has begun until we know its end. The beginning always remains a crucial ingredient in the whole, if is effective and decisive throughout lifetime, until the final end of having been. In contrast, start or outset is the first visible token of the beginning, the first moment in a series of time moments or time slots which follow. It is the first of many, and start must not be confused with the beginning, which has an existential dimension, while start or outset has a physical chronological dimension of time. Being and becoming a person, according to Robert Spemann, starts by saying that I am myself here in front of you, George Simbrunner, and I was always myself, and I began as myself. I did not begin as someone else, and I definitely did not begin as a thing, as something, as an object, because a thing never can become a person. The fertilized germ cell with its autopoietic structures, however, can develop into a person, and that will be discussed. Any begotten child becomes a radical, new, unique human being without any design or control of parents, because the gene pool is randomly distributed in the mitotic and meiotic divisions. A certain sperm type reaches at random the egg cell first to fertilize it, and then of course the epigenetics of the ancestors is given and cannot be changed. The ancestors' lifestyle has an impact on the genetics which is given. Finally, nativity is a term which was coined by Hannah Arendt, and it describes that each human being from the beginning is empowered to behave and to speak in an unpredictable manner, by which he distinguishes himself from others as a unique and unexchangeable being, a radical new, unique human being. So, parents are not the creator, nor the designer, not even the producer of a new human being. They have no deliberate impact on the biological complexity of gene mixing and on the former genetic events. They have no right to a child, a boy or a girl or a healthy child. They do not bestow life to their children. They just pass on life. They do not materialize a plan or design of a child, do not cause the radical new themselves, that do not possess the child. As the famous poet Khalil Gibran states, your children are not your children. They are the sons and daughters of life's longing for itself. They come through you, but not from you. And if they are with you, they are nevertheless not your possession. Parents, however, are the initiators of a child, insofar they wish to have a child and provide conditions for a radical new human being. Khalil Gibran states, you are the bow which emits an arrow full of life. Parents are empowered to exceed or transcend themselves because they bring something about which is beyond themselves, the new human being, a being that is more than each parent can contribute. I, according to Khalil Gibran, I, your child, unfold my own thoughts. You can harbor my body, but not my soul. For my soul is living in the house of tomorrow, which you cannot visit, not even in your dreams. We all agree that certain circumstances and conditions precede the conception of a child. A young couple falls in love, the love intensifies, becomes more intimate, and they may have the wish to father or to conceive a child. This set of circumstances and conditions we call the preconception life world. It precedes the fusion of the pronuclei of the sperm cell and the oocytic cell to form a zygote, which is the beginning of a new, is the new life, start of a new life. Now, the life world preconception will now be described in terms of epigenetic impacts of world situations, world environment, and impact of ancestors. In a very important study by Bygreen in 2014, the authors report epigenetic effects are passed on to three generations. If large fluctuations in food availability during grandparents' early development occurred, they influence grandchildren's cardiovascular mortality. If the paternal grandmother experienced a dramatic change in food supply from good to poor, from poor to good, from good to poor, the risk for a cardiovascular mortality of their granddaughters was 2.7. However, if the parental grandmother experienced exclusively dramatic changes from good food supply to a poor harvest several times, then this risk is increased tenfold to about 21.3. So it's very clear, looking at the transmission of the epigenetic signal from the parental grandmother via the son to the daughter, it indicates an X-linked epigenetic inheritance. Now let us discuss the impact of social experiences on epigenetics. And we describe a study on 32 Holocaust survivors who were compared to 8 Jews of the same age not exposed to Holocaust, and also 22 children from the Holocaust group compared to children from the control group. Epigenetic material was examined, and the investigators examined the cytosine-methylation of the stress regulation gene, which is responsible for higher or lower sensitivity to stress. They found that the Holocaust parents had a much higher rate of methylation of the stress regulation gene than the control, but their offsprings, their descendants, had a lower methylation of the stress regulation gene than the control. This implies that the Holocaust survivors were less sensitive to stress, were more resilient to severe situations. In contrast, their offsprings were more sensitive to stress, were more at risk of developing psychopathology and psychological diseases. Similar studies are available from recent time, for example, female survivors of the Tutsi genocide who were pregnant at the time of exposure were also examined for the promoter methylation of that gene and also in the offsprings. A similar study is obviously available from survivors of the attack on the World Trade Center in September 2001. And all these studies demonstrate the epigenetic impact of experiences on persons and their offsprings. Now, let's look at the live world preconception weeks before conception. Paternal lifestyle 3 months before conception has effects on the sperm and thus on the offspring. In chronic paternal stress, certain messenger substances are elevated in the sperm of the stressed fathers and are associated with a reduced stress reactivity in offsprings. Likewise, a high fat diet alters the sperm, forms also such messenger substances, tsRNA fractions, and cause metabolic disorders in the first generation of offsprings and alter gene expression of metabolic pathways. And the same also occurs if one injects these messengers into a normal zygote. Maternal lifestyle 3 months before conception has also effects on the epigenetic of the egg cell and thus on the offspring. Consequently, the health before conception, the preconception health, is very important. And a couple can do something, a mother can do something for it by reducing weight to an optimal level, by starting folic acid iron substitution, stopping drinking alcohol and smoking 3 months before conception to improve the epigenetic impact. It's very clear that one could in vitro fertilization test for the epigenetics before conception by examining the polar body of the female oocyte, see whether the epigenetics are feasible or not, and likewise you can examine the epigenetic pattern in the sperm. If it is not normal, if it's not feasible, if it's not optimal, you could postpone conception of a child, change your lifestyle for a year, and then re-examine the epigenetic status of the germ cells. Now let's look at the lifetime from conception and pregnancy and so on. Already after conception, the zygote and the ensuing cells are experiencing a dramatic process of methylation and demethylation of the DNA and histones. That means epigenetic patterns are erased and new ones are formed. So epigenetics starts immediately after conception, continues in pregnancy. The mother has an incredible impact on the development of the fetus by her nutrition, her lifestyle, she determines by these factors whether the baby will be healthy in lifetime or develop diseases of fetal origin as an adult. These diseases of fetal origin are the so-called metabolic syndrome with cardiovascular disease, diabetes and obesity. In a close relationship of the fetus to the mother with a personal dialogic communication and prenatal bonding before birth, and then the experience of birth trauma also has a strong impact on the psychological status of a human being, as described by Sigmund Freud, Otto Rank, Gustav Graber and others. The fetus in utero already lives in a hearing space. The infant can listen to the mother's and other participants' voice. The listening infant can already discriminate the voice of its mother from another female. Also two different texts and different melodies, for example, an ascending from a descending melody. And when tested 1 month after birth, the fetus is exposed, for example, to an ascending melody, could remember that after a month after birth, and one could demonstrate that by the reaction of the heart rate according to the melody played. Now it's clear the impact of the mother or the surrogate mother on the intrauterine child by epigenetic programming and auditory inputs has an incredible effect on the developing infant, as we have just discussed. Consequently, the bearing mother, be it a natural mother or a surrogate mother, is more than an incubator and has a share in the parenthood and the origin of the child. This has, of course, important implications on the ethical, legal, social handling of surrogate motherhood. Now, let's look at the lifetime from conception to adulthood with a focus on prenatal, perinatal, and immediate postnatal period. We will discuss the foundation of man in terms of building physical order and of neurobiological and psychological development. Let's start with the building of physical order. We look at the upper graph. It depicts the specific heat production of an individual after conception until birth and end of lifetime. The specific heat production, which is then dissipated at a certain temperature level from the individual, corresponds to what is called entropy export. Entropy is a term for disorder. So when you export entropy, you can build up order. And this build-up of order is increasing very significantly until birth and a short time thereafter, and then order and information decay again in adulthood and, of course, in death. In parallel, the formation of synapses, the capacity to store information in the brain, parallels the build-up of order. The amount of synapses increase up to birth and remain high a while, and then also decay and fall to low levels. Consequently, both building up physical order and information and building up capacity to store information peak around birth and remain high for a while, and this maximum of these two processes separates the foundation from unfolding period and philosophically from becoming and vanishing. So let us go a little bit further and describe the human being in terms of the zoological classification. Any mammalia can be classified, any animals can be classified into nidifugas and nidiculas animals. The nidifugas are animals which are immediately able to move after birth and need no nest, while the nidiculous animals remain in the nest for some time after hatching, after birth. And this classification depends on the process before birth, whether the eyelids are open and the ear channel is open at birth, as is the case in the nidifugas, while in the nidiculous they are born with closed eyes and closed ear channels, and they have to open up during the time thereafter. According to Portman, the human newborn is biologically, zoologically, a nidifugous animal. It has a long gestation, usually it's a single birth, not multipara, and has a very high cerebration index. And although biologically, zoologically, the human being is a nidifugus, the infant needs maternal provision, is dependent on care, actually needs a nest and needs an extra uterine year to become a fully nidifugus individual by locomotion, able to walk, by having a nutrition close to the adult, by sensing and cognition and learning as a child and adult. Consequently, Portman calls the human being a secondary nidiculus, a secondary nest quarter. He says we are born too early and we are experiencing a so-called physiological prematurity, which has nothing to do with the prematurity we know from neonatology. This first extrauterine year is the time where the infant develops trust in oneself and identity and becomes trustworthy. It is the period where trust is learned as a behavior and attitude which is there in all life phases. Very important developmental step, according to Erik Erikson. The infant then develops its psychological characteristics up to the second, latest to the third year as a toddler, and then at that time his psychological characteristics are finalized and fixed. And these five main factors, which are described by the acronym OCEAN, are openness to new experiences, consciousness, meaning that you consciously pursue your tasks, extroversion, you are open to others, you are agreeable, you are kind, or you are neurotic, fearful, depressed, and a sort of angry person. And these five characteristics are prevailing all the lifetime until the end of life. So from the socio-cultural development, we find a human being as a non-reflective toddler, authentic and spontaneous until the age of 2 to 3 years, and then he turns into a reflective, autonomous child with its own will, own decisions, which I call a natural dissident. So, let us look at the whole human existence from the beginning with a life world preceding the conception, followed by a foundation with its biological, communicative, individual and psychological development, which then crosses over and turns over to a period of unfolding the structures laid down in the foundation period. And we look now at the foundation from a wider angle. Biologically, the period through which man develops its basic structure, his fundament for life, corresponds also theologically to the time where the human being is made in God's image according to his likeness. Consequently, the human being founded in his specific structure and made in God's own likeness is bestowed with dignity, which always is given independent of the stage of development, actually from the zygote to the embryo, fetus, and to the end of life. The prenatal man at no time finds himself in a situation of necessity to make decisions, has no opportunity to act on anyone. Foundation of man takes place without conscious free decision and action, takes place before man can choose and want something in and out of freedom. The foundation is also the time which we do not remember consciously and is a development we know nothing of, because only around 15 to 18 months an infant starts to exhibit self-consciousness. Again, consequently, until toddler's age, the human being lives a naive, natural, innocent life, free of responsibility, accountability, of guilt, let alone sin. Consequences of man's foundations, which occur without accountability and the responsibility on his part, are the base for self-acceptance. It enables man to accept him or herself as he was founded. And this, of course, is valid for the others, provides a basis for accepting the other in his right to be such and such, to be different from me, in his or her neediness, with his or her physical and mental weaknesses. The foundation is the base for tolerance, right of assistance, and genuine dialogue between us human beings, between us persons. Thank you very much for your attention.